Honourable guests, ladies and gentlemen, do we have gentlemen in the audience? A few. Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to this session on the role of accountability in the gender equality agenda. My name is Shahira Amin. I'm an independent journalist based in Cairo, Egypt. I'm delighted to be the moderator of this session and even more thrilled to be here in beautiful Kigali. As you know, Rwanda stands out not just among African countries, but globally in its efforts in advancing gender equality, particularly political participation of women. So it's the perfect choice for Women Deliver 2023. Ladies and gentlemen, gender equality is a fundamental human right. It's also a necessary foundation for stability and prosperity, for a better world for all of us. Over the years, governments, civil society, the private sector, and multilaterals have made numerous commitments at various fora like this gathering here, many of which remain unfulfilled today. Although there has been progress in the last decades, it has been slow, and we're far from being on track to meeting the UN SDG on gender equality, which hinders progress on all of the other SDGs. So, in this upcoming panel discussion that we will have today, we'll find out why this is the case and what more can be done to accelerate progress, including by strengthening accountability mechanisms for gender equality commitments. We want to render them more inclusive and also more effective to ensure that every girl and woman on the planet can be empowered and attain their full and fundamental rights to education, to healthcare, and freedom of choice. Our first speaker needs no introduction. She is the voice of millions of girls worldwide struggling for their rights, especially to education. The youngest Nobel Peace Prize laureate, she won the prize at just the age of 17, Malala Yousafzai continues to fight. Malala.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for such a warm welcome. I'm really excited to be here at Women Deliver Summit. 10 years ago, almost to the day, I was 16 years old and visiting the United Nations headquarters for the first time. The Secretary General had invited me to tell my story to an audience of 500 young people. I spent 2 years of my childhood under the terrorism of the Taliban, displaced from my home and banned from going to school because I was a girl. I was shot and nearly killed for speaking out against these injustices. I did not know if my first speech at the United Nations would be my last, my only chance to ask the world to send every girl to school. I am happy to say that I was wrong. Over the last 10 years, I graduated from university. I traveled to 31 countries. I started Malala Fund to support education activists and amplify girls' voices. I tried in everything that I did to bring the world's attention to girls like me. Millions of girls denied their right to education by poverty, patriarchy, climate, and conflict. And I'm proud that as a community, we have made some progress. Raising the global standard for what good education looks like. But our victories can't hide how little has changed or even gotten worse for girls. Since the pandemic, many donor countries have cut their aid to education, and many low and middle income countries are forced to choose between paying down their debts or paying for education. Across sub-Saharan Africa, the total number of girls out of school has gone up. And now, Afghanistan is the only country in the world to ban girls from a full education, a situation that many, including the UN Secretary General, are calling gender apartheid. 10 years ago, in that same UN speech, I declared, with a 16-year-old's optimism, that one child, one teacher, one book, and one pen can change the world. Some of you may even have seen this hanging on a poster at your office or on a tote bag around your arm. I have seen the Etsy shops. But I will tell you today what I did not know then. One child can't change the world, neither can one prime minister, one teacher, or one activist. No one can change the world on their own. Of course, change can begin with just one person. But to ensure a bright future for girls, we must work collectively. Here's what this could look like. We move from individual activities to building movements for accountability and change. And we start by focusing on what we have already been promised, holding our leaders accountable for the commitments they make to girls and then abandon when the spotlight goes away. But we should go further. We must ensure that we are funding the movements led by girls like we actually want them to win. Because sadly, we know all the rhetoric around girls has not been translated into significant increase in resources reaching to them directly. The little data we do have paints a stark picture. The World Bank estimates that less than 2 cents of every dollar spent on international aid is directed towards adolescent girls. Philanthropic funding is equally low, with only 70% of the funding going to women and girls overall. And even when resources do reach girls, they're often short-term and restricted, dictating girls what they can do and how they can do it. It is easy to look around an audience like this one at Women Deliver and feel like we are the good guys. It is the people outside these walls who don't get it. But the truth is, we are all failing this generation of girls. Even among the boldest feminists, girls are often an afterthought. As time slips away, I need us all to demand more from our leaders, our funders, our own institutions, and ourselves. The girls I have met around the world have incredible courage and creativity. If we match their determination, fund their work, and follow their lead, I know we will help shape a better world. A world where girls can live joyful, playful, carefree lives. A world where girls are free from violence. A world where girls don't have to carry the burdens of the crises caused by adults. A world where all girls can get a free, safe, and quality education. That is the world I invite us all to build together. Thank you.
Malala, for inspiring us. The world needs more Malalas, don't you agree? She's a living example of what young girls can achieve when they have the opportunity to learn and thrive. So before I introduce our esteemed panelists, let's watch a videotaped message from philanthropist and global advocate for women and girls, Melinda Gates.
Hi, I'm honored to join this year's Women Deliver Conference. I wish I could be there with you in person. It's been an honor to work alongside the Women Deliver community over the years in pursuit of our shared mission, a world where every woman and every girl can reach their full potential. We all know the world is facing difficult challenges. People still feel the effects of the pandemic every day. Climate change is doing great harm, especially to people who are already struggling. A war in Europe has caused great tragedy for people in Ukraine and food and energy insecurity around the world. I get frustrated sometimes because too many world leaders take precisely the wrong lesson from today's state of affairs. They say explicitly to my face or implicitly by their inaction that we can't afford to live up to the promises we've made to women and girls at a time like this. But you know that at a time like this is exactly when we need to tear down the barriers that are standing in the way of this gender equality. You know that our communities and our countries will be so much more resilient when women and girls everywhere get the support they need to thrive. What I hope world leaders know is that if they care about pandemic preparedness or hunger or their GDP, then they care about the health and well-being of women and girls. The Gates Foundation invests in health innovations and nutrition that meet women's unique needs because healthy women are the backbone of flourishing communities. We invest in contraceptive options and pathways to economic opportunity because when women have power over their own bodies and their own money, they transform societies. This can be a reality only if decisions about women's lives are made by women, not for women, and if all leaders understand what's achievable if they deliver on their commitments to women and girls. When I talk about this virtuous cycle, I often speak about the data, like the 26% increase in global GDP that is possible if women can participate fully in the workforce. I speak about the women I meet, healthcare workers, caregivers, farmers, entrepreneurs, who have lifted their families out of poverty because of access to healthcare and capital and all the building blocks of a prosperous society. I'm optimistic we'll see great progress, especially with the more than 200,000 members of the Women Deliver community working every day to build a world that's better because it's equal. Thank you for your tireless commitment to women and girls.
Many thanks to Melinda Gates for her very valuable contribution. Indeed, our communities and countries will be much more resilient if women can participate more in the workforce and girls can access education, healthcare, and the freedom to choose. Our upcoming panel discussion will explore the gaps in accountability that hinder the fulfillment of gender equality commitments. It will also showcase some effective accountability strategies and suggest ways in which all stakeholders can work together to ensure that gender equality promises are met. Without further ado, let's welcome our expert panelists. Dr. Geeta Gao Gupta is Ambassador at Large for the Office of Global Women's Issues in the US government. Welcome, Dr. Gupta. Julissa Tambuman is from Equal Measures 2030. Gertrude Fefuama, or Gertie, Global Advocacy Manager at Sightsavers. Welcome, Gertrude. Louise Holt is Director General of the Social Development Bureau at Global Affairs Canada. Welcome. The Honourable Linda Tabuya is Minister for Women, Child and Poverty Alleviation of Fiji. Welcome. And last but certainly not least is Pauline Faith Gato. She is Executive Director of the Girls Health Alliance. You'll find their full bios on the app. Ladies, welcome. It's a great pleasure having you with me here today. Gertie, let's begin with you. As the Global Advocacy Manager at Sightsavers, you work to promote the rights of persons with disabilities. How can we ensure that accountability mechanisms for gender equality commitments are inclusive and address the specific challenges faced by women and girls with disabilities?
Sakira, thank you. And a very important question, I agree. I would attempt to deal with only four areas because that is what time will allow. In this short time, I would want to raise a point about involvement of women and girls with disabilities, including gender minorities, at the design stage. I wish to talk about the fact that issues and women and girls with disabilities has to be a cross-cutting. The third point I wish to raise is that disaggregated data as part of intersectional data collection is essential. And last but not least, to answer this part of the question, the meaningful and effective participation and involvement of women and girls with disabilities, including those with gender minority, when these are looked at. So let's look at it. Sharika. So what happens is that to be able to ensure accountability, we would need to make sure that commitments start at the beginning. It has to be at the start, it has to be at the design stage, not at the implementation, and not good enough being at the monitoring stage. In the minds of many, women and girls with disabilities could be parked, is not important, could be delayed, or left for other people and other agencies, maybe some special group to come and deal. This is not a good way of ensuring that the process of accountability mechanism will be effective. So when it is like that, issues of disability is not sufficiently reflected in most communities. I would also wish to talk about cross-cutting, and that in this issue, issues of women and girls with disabilities does not have to be packed. It has to be the center of everything. Whether it's indigenous, youth, adults, we should be there. We also know that work of data, when we're not counted, we are lost. So disaggregated data is important, has to be intersectional, has to be specific, and this is how we'll be able to know what we are doing so that we can have the right mechanism in place. But also, the lived experiences of women and girls with disabilities, including those in gender minority, are important. So we need to consult and engage with representative organizations, women and girls, including groups, so that we hear well, we are guided, and we have to be at the table, and we have to be at the center. Decision is ours. Thank you.
So women and girls with disabilities have to be at the table and they have to be at the center. Very important message from Gertie. Thank you, Gertie. Louise, your government plays a crucial role in shaping policies and initiatives for gender equality. I know that the Government of Canada made a series of historical commitments 4 years ago at Women Deliver 2019. So what has the accountability journey of these commitments been?
Yeah, thank you. So happy to be here and talk about our experience in Canada. Absolutely, Women Deliver 2019 in Vancouver, Canada was a very big moment for us in Canada. I think that these kind of high-level moments are opportunities to really galvanize, energize, and move forward on commitments. And for us, at that moment, we had just previously launched our first ever feminist international assistance policy in the context of a feminist foreign policy. And so Women Deliver really allowed us an opportunity to kind of concretize or come forward with real commitments to back up the ambitions of our feminist international assistance policy. So two of the biggest commitments I think that we made at the time were a huge shift in our international assistance to really focus on sexual and reproductive health and health of women and girls, and with a target of, by 2023, this year, reaching an annual disbursement of $1.4 billion for women and children's health, of which half of that would be sexual and reproductive health. And within that, in neglected areas like access to safe abortion, gender-based violence, comprehensive sexuality education, and ending child marriage. For us, that meant fully 20% of our international assistance dollars was going to be dedicated in this area, and a big, big shift in a short time. The second big commitment that we made was launching and contributing $300 million in foundational support to the Equality Fund. And the Equality Fund, since that time, I'm really pleased to say, in the 4 short years as a women's fund, has stood itself up, has really become an important player in the feminist funding ecosystem. In that short time, they've now managed to disperse as much as almost $35 million to over 100 women's rights organizations, who have in turn on-granted to over 500 local organizations through that. And we have, as of this year, met our target for $1.4 billion in women and girls' health, $700 million to reproductive, sexual and reproductive health this year. For us, that was really big. We're a really relatively small country, a small donor, and that was a huge shift for us. But it wasn't just even a shift in terms of the funding, which was a big funding shift for us. It was also the approach, because behind that was a commitment that we would apply a feminist approach to implementing all of our programming and working with our partners. And the extra challenge that we would do it quickly. So those targets of shifting from 2019 to 2023, meeting those targets, for those of us that were in the department and in government, some of you might know that governments are not the fastest or most agile organizations and can sometimes take a long time to change. But we were really forced to rethink how we did it. And I have to say, I think the biggest factor for me that enabled us to actually achieve and get us to where we are now is a really single-minded leadership at the highest levels, right up to our Prime Minister, who really drove the government institutions to stick to those commitments, to keep on track. They asked us to report quarterly, so 4 times a year, where we were at, and they wanted to see not just the accountability for the money going out the door, but the results, that the money was getting into the hands of women and meeting the needs of those women and women's rights organizations, community groups, where they were most needed. The other side of that, I guess I would say, is just the continued, and you'll see that as well, that the continued face that over those 4 years that we had to do all that, we had the compounding factors, and we just heard Melinda Gates speak to this, of COVID, increased conflict, and it was something that our political leaders never lost sight of, that within the light of in face of COVID, in face of increased crisis, they really saw, as she said, that it was more important than ever to ensure that we were addressing some of the most important barriers to equality, and that's gender equality, in all of our work, and enabled us to keep on track with that.
Canada, living up to its commitments. Of course, we do need political will, we need inclusive policies, and we need investments in the gender equality agenda. But laws and policies, while they can help, they're only one part of the equation. The other part of the equation is the individual and cultural attitudes and behavior that hinder progress on gender equality. Deeply entrenched social norms are much more difficult to eliminate. Honorable Linda Tabuya, as the Minister of Women, Child and Poverty Alleviation in Fiji, you have firsthand experience in advancing gender equality at the national level. In your opinion, what are the key challenges to translating gender equality commitments into meaningful change at the grassroots level?
Thank you. As a new minister, barely 6 months, I realized as I was listing these challenges that I identified myself as a feminist leader coming into the national stage. And as I was listing these, to me the number one challenge, as you mentioned, is the presence of deep-rooted cultural, social, and religious norms, traditions, and beliefs that perpetuate gender inequality. And this is, we need a long-term commitment to be able to get rid of this, but this is something we have to deal with, especially as women leaders and advocating for gender equality. Second, and this is the elephant in the room, I think, is the resistance to change and power imbalances. It's important to acknowledge that change inherently involves a redistribution of power, and we've got to give it up for Rwanda for achieving this in the redistribution of power to have more women leaders in parliament and across the sectors. Third is the lack of awareness and understanding regarding gender equality issues, policies, and their potential benefits by the whole population and relevant stakeholders that can create barriers to the adoption and implementation of these policies. The fourth, I think, is something we tend to overlook, and this is the nature of politics and the electoral cycles. The pressure for immediate results can sometimes result in short-term, surface-level approaches that fail to address the underlying and root causes of gender inequalities. Fifth, in my view, is weak institutional capacity. While we may set high aspirations and ambitious policy frameworks, we often let pass the practical aspects of implementation. Again, the lack of technical expertise, financial constraints, and inadequate institutional and coordination infrastructure can limit ability to effectively translate policies into action. And sixth is the mechanisms of accountability are weak and the lack of data collection. This is very important and was mentioned by my sister earlier. Accountability is closely tied to data. Data talks and reveals. Without reliable data and tracking mechanisms, it becomes difficult to hold institutions and stakeholders and politicians accountable for their commitments and actions. And of course, this is my ultimatum and my seventh. Having feminist leaders in positions of power is essential for advancing gender equality agendas. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Tabuya. You mentioned data. So Julissa is the expert here from Equal Measures 2030. You focus on data and evidence to drive progress in gender equality. How can data be effectively utilized to monitor and hold accountable commitments made towards gender equality, especially in low and middle income countries where data is often lacking?
Thank you, Shahira, and it's an absolute honor to be here. Thank you for having me.
Can you raise your voice?
Sure. So accountability mechanism, as you rightly mentioned, we need it to ensure that we hold those same actors who have made the commitment as part of their international and national development agendas responsible if they don't deliver. Now, data can help with this. So that data will shine a light on whether we are making progress or whether we are falling behind. And it can help inform policymakers, international organizations, or civil society organizations make informed decision, take corrective action. Now, before we talk about how we can effectively use data, we need to make sure that those data are available. So the data I'm talking about is reliable, relevant, timely gender data that reflects the lived experience of women and girls, so not just regular data. Now, we mostly don't have this data, right? And some of the challenges that of collecting this data is because most countries don't have the statistical capacity to collect this data. And we're talking about low and middle income countries. More than 100 of these countries do not have robust civic registration and vital statistics system. So they can collect regular statistics, let alone gender data. On top of that, the biggest commitment that governments have made in the last decade, which is the Sustainable Development Goals, if you look at the indicators of the SDG framework, almost 80% of the indicators are gender blind. So that doesn't really help because it decreases investment and effort of countries to invest in gender data, basically. Now, when gender data do exist, they normally haven't made available for government or for civil society organization to use. So there's a lack of access and capacity here in using that. So I would say first, make those data available. And gender disaggregated data is the bare minimum. We need data that use intersectional analysis. So more criteria, the better. So invest in all you funders here, please invest in improving data. And then make sure that this data is accessible and available for non-technical audience. So I'm talking about gender advocates, feminist movement, young feminist movement, and women's rights organization. Make sure that they can understand, they know how to find this data, where to find it, and how to use it. Because the power of data in the hands of feminist movements are massive. So, and that will help drive accountability effort as long as we have that.
So the message is make the data accessible and available, particularly to feminist organizations. Thank you very much for that, Jalissa. Pauline, as the executive director of the Girls Health Alliance, you work to improve the health and well-being of girls worldwide. Now, how can we ensure that accountability mechanisms prioritize the specific needs and rights of adolescent girls who often face unique challenges in accessing education, healthcare, and other essential services?
Thank you, Shahara. Before moving to answer your question, I want to say I feel very privileged being on this stage representing the voice of millions of girls and young women around the world, including my own country, Liberia. Now, to answer your question, I want to say leave no gap behind and have young people as part of the conversation from the planning to the monitoring and evaluation stages. And you know what? I want to say we are the table. Because without the table, there will be no meaningful conversation. Now tell me, how can some 60 years old men and women sit in a room exclusively to address period poverty when they are not the one experiencing menstruation? Yeah. You know, and I know, there have been a series of commitments made for the advancement of girls' and women's rights. But now, more than ever before, I want to say it is time for our leaders to walk the talk. Heads of state, government representatives here, civil society organizations, let me assure you that the girls and young women of my generation are no more in the position to negotiate their rights. We are here at Women Deliver 2023 and the girls and young women all around the world to demand our space. We are here for business and we want to ensure that meaningful commitments are made to advance the rights of girls and young women. Thank you.
Very assertive indeed. Representing the voices of many young people around the world. Dr. Gupta, you have extensive experience in promoting gender equality. How can we ensure that accountability mechanisms prioritize the voices and needs of marginalized groups?
Thank you for that question. I first want to say how important accountability is. Many of the other panelists have made the point. It's of great value to me when I worked in civil society, in academia, and now in government. I'm in government just for 2 months now. It's extremely important to me that I be held accountable. So I will say that for accountability to truly work, it's a two-way street. You need government to be transparent, to set goals that they share with the public. You need them to have indicators to measure progress that they announce, set targets, and be inclusive in the way they do all of that. Mm-hmm. On the CSO side, particularly women's organizations, grassroots organizations, they have to be bold, hold governments accountable by measuring progress through the data that they collect, yes, but also reporting out what was successful and what was not, so that governments get some feedback. I think that is a two-way street. So for accountability work, that's very, very important. But accountability without the inclusion of everyone, of all marginalized populations, disadvantaged populations, is not worth much. And I'm very proud that the United States administration has built that kind of an approach into its policy processes throughout. The Biden-Harris administration in 2021 established the Gender Policy Council, and the Gender Policy Council developed the first ever national strategy on gender equity and equality. And it was done with a robust consultation process where input was sought at all stages on setting the goals, on setting the indicators to measure progress. It's a strategy that covers both domestic and foreign policies and programs, and it's impressive to see how every department across government now can be held accountable for the progress they've made by civil society organizations. I can tell you that the office that I lead, the Global Women's Issues Office in the State Department, recently developed a national strategy on economic security and gender-based violence, again, with a robust consultation process. And we learned a few things. So for example, it was civil society organizations that helped us understand the direct link between the climate crisis and women's safety and security, so that is now included in our gender-based violence strategy. On the economic security side, it was civil society organizations and partners who emphasized the importance of women's unpaid and undervalued care burden, mm-hmm, and how important that was in order for women to truly benefit from economic opportunities, for us to understand that. So I'll say that when grassroots organizations, marginalized groups, civil society organizations are included in the process and they can hold us accountable, governments make greater progress.
But wouldn't you agree that the flow of financial resources to civil society organizations needs to be monitored and assessed to ensure that it's building the capacities of women to exercise their voices and power?
Absolutely. I mean, you need strong civil society for this to work. And feminist organizations, I will say to you, since the Beijing conference was such a success, much of the money that supported feminist organizations on the ground, grassroots organizations, has dried up over time. And we need to increase the flow of resources. So I agree with you, we need much more money going to organizations on the ground so that they can hold their governments accountable. But they can also set agendas, they can sort of introduce the perspectives that they see, the realities on the ground, so that their governments can respond more effectively.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. Gertie, back to you. Any success stories that you'd like to share with us about amplifying the voices of persons with disabilities within the accountability framework.
Well, thank you so much. The work you've done so far, Shakira, has brought some successes, and I wish to raise four of them. The first is accessibility, information, communication, and environment. When we couldn't join the Generational Equality Forum in 2021, we didn't only complain, but we quickly came together to develop the Feminist Accessibility Protocol that will encourage all of you to sign, including states. And we will say that women deliver. Bravo, you were the first to sign. And you've used it for this session. We see improvement, and we know we're going to work with you to improve it. And we would want, and we're ready for you to nominate somebody to be on the board and the voices so that we can work better. Another example I wish to raise quickly is at a community level using a scorecard as SDG processes in many countries. And so we have increased service providers' understanding and accountability. And for example, in Ghana, in the pilot efforts, social protection for women and girls with disabilities in that community is being paid better attention. They are being looked for. Venues are more accessible, and friendly environment is beginning to grow. The report talks about women and girls with disabilities. Fast forward, also at the global level, for instance, at the Community on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, thank you, states, that we now have gender parity, because there was an Equal UN campaign which brought us the parity. But without state continuing, and without civil society and feminist organizations supporting women and girls with disabilities, we may lose it. 2024, we want gender parity. So please, we need that support. And working group on women is being working. We have also done some work on Africa Disability Protocol. It has good portions for women and girls with disabilities. Africa, we are on our land here. Please ratify so that it come into force. I would also mention the success we are beginning to achieve with UN Women. Targets didn't include disability. Only about 1% of all the commitments are on disability. And so we started engaging as part of the midterm and growing forward. And it's been slow, but UN Women have started coming our way. We're only hopeful that we're going to fast track this and make amends. And so then we have many more success stories as we look at accountability mechanisms being available. And to say that when women and girls with disabilities, including the minorities, are at a table, we don't only talk about disability, we influence change. One out of every five women is a person with disability. We count. Please give us the spaces, and we'll have more stories to share. Thank you.
Well said, Gertie. Thank you. Louise, my next question is for you. How can governments better collaborate with civil society organizations and with grassroots activists to ensure more effective accountability for their gender equality commitments?
Thank you. Well, certainly, and as you've heard from my colleagues here on this panel, vibrant civil society always holds government to account, and that is always their role. And it's great to see such passion and commitment, particularly in some of our youth leaders today coming forward, and will no doubt keep us accountable. But it does speak to the fact, sort of as a counterpoint to what I said, I mentioned the importance of feminist leadership in our own accountability journey, and heard that repeated as well by the Honourable Minister. The other side of that is that accountability can't only be top down. It has to come from the bottom up and has to be a true partnership model, including with civil society. For us in Canada, in our experience, I mentioned, we had to make a huge shift in the areas that we were funding, the amounts of money that we were moving to areas that we really hadn't worked in before. And that meant for us new partnerships, new approaches, new ways of working at almost every level, from how we engaged partners, how we moved money to partners, how we did reporting against our funding commitments that were out there, and really ultimately meant engaging partners from the outset so that we ensured we were responding to their needs where they needed them and not dictating what we think they should be doing. Having those conversations, though, was very difficult. It wasn't always easy, and we realized what a big shift it was. And it also really showed us that in many ways, we didn't always speak the same language, coming as a government funder, or as a multilateral organization, or as a local organization. And making sure that we had all of the voices and all the relevant voices around the table from marginalized and most marginalized groups, whether with disabilities, making sure we had youth voices at the table, particularly when we were trying to address the needs of youth or people with disabilities. So we really had to do a complete shift. We implemented what we call our feminist monitoring, evaluation, and learning approach. We had many difficult conversations, and we've continued to learn. But what we've seen is that when we put that forward and we put in place project and program frameworks where the beneficiaries have been owners as well of the process, of the owners of the data, owners of the evaluation data, we're getting amazing results in a very short time. And it's something that we're very committed to continuing to do. That's why some of you may have heard of the Alliance for Feminist Movements. Coming out of the Generation Equality Forum, we joined forces with the Equality Fund and Ford Foundation to launch the Alliance for Feminist Movements. And it really is intended to be a community of practice, a safe space for donors, philanthropic donors, governments, civil society, feminists, LGBTQI groups to come together and have a discussion about how we move more and better funding to grassroots and local women's rights organizations and feminist movements to achieve our collective ambition. And when we launched it at Generation Equality Forum, we weren't quite sure if the traction was there. But our own experience had been that we felt that that would be a really important learning forum for all of us. And we now have almost 400 members in the Alliance, and we look forward to inviting many more to join us and continuing that conversation.
Thank you. Well, collaboration between civil society and accountability institutions and governments is crucial so that they can support each other in the accountability framework, but also between civil society and vulnerable communities. So all stakeholders. Minister Tabuya, how can governments and communities work together to bridge the gap between policy commitments and tangible outcomes for women and girls, especially those in marginalized communities?
Recently, Fiji, we reached a milestone by launching a comprehensive whole-of-government, evidence-based, transformative, and whole-of-society, costed and inclusive national action plan to prevent violence against all women and girls, aiming to stop it before it starts. It's the second only in the world behind Australia.
Wow.
Other countries have their national action plans, but why these are different is because it's based on actual evidence and data. Now, the National Action Plan is centered on challenging and shifting social and cultural norms, recognizing that deeply ingrained social norms contribute to gender inequality. The NAP takes a targeted approach to address and transform these norms. We've also conducted a thorough costing of the NAP and its actions, securing funding for the next 5 years in collaboration with development partners. Moreover, we have demonstrated our commitment to gender equality by allocating a significant portion of our national budget. We just passed the budget last week, and it's the first time ever for Fiji to achieve gender-responsive budgeting in our budget. There are annual contributions from other ministries with a budget line to the National Action Plan to prevent gender-based violence. And this is a milestone achievement for
Congratulations.
Fiji.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Now, to strengthen the implementation efforts, we've established a dedicated implementation unit. This unit will be hosted by the UN Women. Thank you, UN Women, for your support. But this will gradually transition into an independent agency. The purpose of this unit, of course, is to provide essential technical expertise, coordination, monitoring, evaluation, and support in the effective execution of this NAP. Lastly, in Parliament, as politicians with a strong commitment to gender equality, we envision this NAP as a long-term journey. We recognize that achieving comprehensive gender equality requires time, perseverance, and a multifaceted approach. Therefore, we've set our sights on a 10-year plan, acknowledging that real change takes time and requires sustained effort. This is only just the beginning for us, but our sense of hope is coupled with our commitment. And of course, as a leader, I am deeply committed to ensuring that we prevent violence before it happens and that the National Action Plan brings about tangible changes in the lives of all Fijian women and girls. Thank you.
Best of luck. Thank you so much. So we're fast running out of time. Just a couple more questions to you, Jalissa. What are some examples of successful data-driven approaches to accountability that you've observed?
Thank you, Shahira. So there are a lot of global accountability mechanisms, and one of them is, some of you are familiar, the UN Women Flagship Program, making every woman and girl count. But today I really like to shine a light on the data-driven work that people that are leading from the front lines have been doing. So one of the Equal Measures 2030 Coalition members in Indonesia, in my home country, Kapal Perempuan, collected data on the local level related on child marriage, and they use it to run campaign on the local level and municipal level and influence decision makers on the national level. As a result of their collective advocacy with the feminist network on the ground, the Indonesian parliament overwhelmingly voted to increase their age of marriage for girls from 16 to 19, same as boys. So that's a really huge win. And that is because of data and because of the work of our feminist leaders on the ground. And another quick example is also as amazing is another coalition member in Kenya, Roots Kenya. They created this gender data dashboard, which is basically an online data visualization tool that can be accessed by government, by civil society organization, and it has been extensively used because the dashboard breaks down data from national level, like women in parliamentary, to household level, like family planning. So it has been extensively used as an accountability mechanism because it's a social accountability mechanism because government authorities look at it and they not only feel pressured looking at the citizen-generated data, but also feel motivated that, right, we can monitor our implementation because we have the data directly and timely. So that's another example of how transformative data that is driven by people on the ground can be.
The power of data, because it really makes gender biases visible. Thank you for that, Jalissa. Our last question is to you, Pauline. So what strategies have you found effective in empowering adolescent girls in accountability framework?
Thank you. As a youth activist working with girls and young women, including young people, I want to give you three answers. The first one is empower girls and young women to take charge of their bodies, to make informed decisions about issues that affect their lives. But not only that, empower girls and young women to lead without fear or intimidation. The second one is ensure that girls and young women have access to quality education and life-changing opportunities. Example I gave you is the Women Deliver Young Leaders program. We all have our testimonies of how that program is changing our lives. The second example I also want to give is the African Young Leaders Initiative. Those are all opportunities and educative platforms that we can increase, have more opportunities so that girls and young women can be empowered to make informed decisions. Lastly, 25 adolescent girls-led initiatives and grassroots feminist movement must be prioritized as we are on the front line daily promoting gender equality in our communities, villages, and towns. We need more youth-led, youth-friendly funding opportunities. We have the Purposeful Girls Funds. We also have the Young Feminist Fund by Fridad, and then we have the UN Trust Fund, grassroots funds are for community-led organizations. These are all opportunities we need. If we have the education you give us, the resources, I can tell you that we can do great things. Give us the opportunity and watch us lead with a difference. Thank you.
Wow, very powerful message there. I'm afraid that's all we have from this panel. Many thanks. Please give a big round of applause to these remarkable women. Many thanks for a very thought-provoking discussion. You can leave the stage now. Thank you very much. Thank you. See you later, ladies. Thank you, Minister. Thank you. So coming up next are the lightning talks, and we have three remarkable speakers who will share their insights on promoting gender equality. First, Wangechai Wachira. She's Executive Director, the Center of Rights, Education and Awareness of Kenya. We'll also be hearing from two other speakers, so please do stay with us. And then we have a very important declaration on FGM. So I won't just... So we're waiting now for our speaker for the lightning talks. She'll be joining us. All right. Perhaps until she comes onto the stage, let me share with you a story about FGM, female genital mutilation, from Egypt. When I started off as a journalist, female genital mutilation was a taboo topic. You couldn't talk about it. So I did my first story on FGM back in 2002, and it wasn't talked about. And I would get calls from officials asking me, why are you tarnishing Egypt's image? I always told them that don't do it and I won't report it. I'm only reporting it because it's happening. 6 years later, in 2008, we finally had a decree criminalizing FGM in Egypt. It's not the end of the story. There's a lot more work to be done. Of course, we need awareness campaigns for the grandmothers who continue to push to have their granddaughters cut. We need to target religious leaders who are still reluctant to condemn FGM. And community leaders need to be on board. So the fight continues. Healthcare, of course, because that's the big challenge. End FGM. All right, we're ready now for the lightning talks. Excellent. Wangechi Wachira. Hello, dear.
Good evening, everyone. I am very, very excited and very, very honored to be here this evening and having a very, very important conversation around accountability. But before that, we have a 3-minute video. So I invite you, popcorns, I hope you have them. I hope you have a soda so that we can watch. Video, where are you?
That is the statement from the Chief Justice of the country to the President, advising him to dissolve Parliament. This is all to do with the implementation, or lack thereof, of legislation for the two-thirds gender rule. In this 10-page letter, he has listed the various attempts by Parliament, as well as those who have taken the issue to court. He's talked about the six petitions which state, and I quote, 9 years, four court orders, Parliament has failed, refused, and or neglected to enact requisite legislation, and therefore they were telling the CJ to dissolve Parliament. Now, let me read you the last part of it here, where he actually makes that declaration to the President. He says, and I quote, on the material placed before me, it is incontestable that Parliament has not complied with a High Court order, and as such, for over 9 years, Parliament has not enacted the legislation required to implement the two-thirds gender rule, which, as the Court of Appeal observed, is clear testimony of Parliament's lackadaisical attitude and conduct in this manner. It goes on to say, there is no doubt that the dissolution of Parliament will cause inconvenience and even economic hardship, that there is no gain without pain. In the circumstances, let us endure pain if we must, if only to remind ourselves as a country, and particularly that choices on constitutional obligations have consequences. He finishes off with this. In the result, Your Excellency, it is my constitutional duty to advise you, the President of the Republic of Kenya, which I hereby do, to dissolve Parliament in accordance with Article 261, subsection 7, and it is dated today. And that is all to do with the failure of Parliament, particularly this administration since 2013, to enact laws that would implement the two-thirds.
Thank you, thank you. Now, seeing that video is really about accountability, but it doesn't show how accountability, particularly for gender equality work, is done. But advocates like ourselves who are here today, they know we must continue to push for accountability. I will not get into the details of that video because we have been able to document the stories of women in Kenya trying to get into the table of leadership, especially for parliament. However, I'm going to highlight some of the things that we have learned as an organization, but also as a movement, is that when you're doing accountability work, we must be bold and fearless. We must be bold and fearless. And for me, why we must be bold and fearless is because in this case, we took our parliament to court and we said, dissolve parliament, because we gave them a duty to put in a legislation so that our framework, so that we can be able to have women into leadership positions. The parliament has failed, has neglected, and has refused to put in a framework whereby we can be able to have women in leadership positions. So boldness must be able to be infused in our work around accountability. I must say that we also reach out to other women's rights organizations. And there was a lot of fear. There was a lot of whispers. Can we really go? Can we not go? So as two women's rights organizations and one fearless feminist crew and Crown Trust, I must actually put it in full, is Community Advocacy Trust. We went to court together so that we do not erase their work. But even speaking to the development partners, though again, very few of them were willing to support work. But there is one who came on board, Urgent Action Fund, and said, we are going to support this work. So a big clap for Urgent Action Fund. What have we learned from this work? Accountability work. You must be committed, you must be consistent, and why? The court process in Kenya, it's a long journey. You need resources. It takes time. For a matter around accountability to increase women in leadership positions, it took us 9 years. For finally, the Chief Justice, at the tail end of his term, that's the only time he was able to say, dissolve this parliament. So, and as we are doing this, we are in an ecosystem. So as we went to court many times, is that we also had another ecosystem of other women's rights organizations. So the court process is happening, the women's rights organizations are drafting bills, the women members of parliament, we are having caucuses with them, we are speaking to men members of parliament so that then they can be able to support our bill. Unfortunately, up to date, Kenya has not put in a policy or a framework whereby women can be represented. Yet, in our constitution, it's very clear that we must be able to have not more than 2/3 of women in leadership position. So, that we have all these commitments, and they are good, and they look very beautiful on paper. And I'm sure in this room, there are so many countries within the region, or globally at the world level, that our governments have made commitments, but when it comes to implementation, it does not happen. So can we go round and round in circles around countries having laws, but they're not putting in the budget that is required? This means that commitments are good, but if they're not followed with actions, there is no transformation that is going to happen to our women and girls. Is that a true or not true fact? Now, the other one for me that is very, very critical is that we have commitments, but we go round and round around laws and commitments. But we need the goodwill. We need the investment. We need the political will. We need the financial investment. We need our girls to be freed so that they can be able to have a different change and experience an environment that is conducive for them. But I must also leave you with hope, because now we have a new government in place. In fact, when the president was sworn in his first memo, he acknowledged there is a dissolution order for parliament. And he has proposed to parliament, you must be able to put a legislation so that we can have more women into leadership position. And therefore, as an organization, we are in that caucus. We are in that space so that we can be able to push the baton. Because the work that we are doing around accountability, it is not a short race. This is a marathon, and we must be prepared. Thank you, everyone. And now, I want to introduce our second speaker who will come after me. She's a leader. She's currently the North America Director for Women Health Lift. And this organization is very, very powerful because their mission as an organization is to expand the power and the influence of women in health. I believe health affects all of us in one way in this room. Her name is Charlene Ban, and she's ready to be able to take the stage. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you.
This is what happens when you work for a women's leadership organization. You get a cheer squad everywhere you go. Thank you. Thank you to Women Deliver and to the people of Rwanda for this time and space in solidarity. It's an honor to share this stage with so many incredible women, many of whom have played a pivotal role in building global movements, and some who are movements unto themselves. The women present in this room and outside of this room are the reason why commitments were made in Beijing and in Nairobi. You all are why we have the Gender Equality Forum today. These forums and commitments were necessary steps on the path to gender equality. But were they enough? Our team at Women Lift Health has been trying to understand what needs to be done at the individual, institutional, and societal level to create a healthier and more gender equal world. And do you know what we keep coming back to? People. Investing in people. Investing in the leadership of people. And not in their ability not only to create change, but also to hold change makers accountable. Accountability must begin at the top, And creating sustainable change requires a prioritized investment in leadership. CEO sponsorship is fundamental to creating change in organizations. But we cannot build sustainable cultures of diversity, equity, and inclusion until these values permeate throughout organizations. Similarly, commitments, messaging, and goals from heads of state are all crucial steps on the path to gender equality, and we need to do more. Accountability is created through formal and informal means. Formal targets, goals, and metrics are incredibly important. We've heard about them today. But today, I want to talk about informal accountability, which is about creating cultural change. Change that fosters authenticity and consistency, values safety, inclusive decision-making, and collective action towards gender equality. Informal accountability is not just about what you say, it's about what you do. How many of us belong to organizations which have set targets, published statements, made commitments, and at the same time constantly excused toxic behavior and propagated cultures of I, and me? Accountability is ultimately about power and what you do with it. Let me tell you about one of our alumna, Quint Toon. Quint, are you in the audience? If you are, please stand up and say hello. Quint is the founder and president of Mobilizing Myanmar. Quint saw the financial exclusion of women in her country, and she made an intentional use of her leadership and power to create change. She used her expertise in engineering and telecommunications to create a financial inclusion initiative that's leveraging smartphones to connect women to economic opportunity. And her team's actions led the Myanmar government to mandate that mobile coverage extend to 95% of the population. Can you imagine that? Programs like Mobilizing Myanmar could be a game changer for women around the world. Women have the power to design a system and hold it accountable. Until we invest in leadership, leadership at all levels and across sectors, in the government, in organizations, in the community, at home, until we recognize the need for safety and trust, fostering open and transparent dialogue, until we cede space and ownership and flip the power and privilege equation to put women and girls in charge of designing solutions for themselves, until we do that, nothing will change. We'll still be talking about equality, discussing it in conferences and summits, and hearing that it could take, quote, 131 years, I heard someone say over 200 years yesterday, to close the global gender gap after an entire generation of progress was lost to COVID-19. Just think about that. So at Women Lift Health, we invest in the leadership of mid-career women in global public health and foster ownership and agency to push for accountability in institutions around the world. We bring together amazing women, many of whom are in this room, from academia, government, NGOs, private and philanthropic organizations. The women leaders in our cohorts represent a diversity of countries, cultures, identities, and experiences. When we first created this journey, some people questioned that cross-sectoral approach. Today, we know that this diversity is fundamental to our secret sauce. These women are learning from each other. They're learning from each other's contextual and technical expertise, amplifying each other's confidence, voice, and agency. Senior mentors are bringing their institutional knowledge and role modeling to these women and helping them to expand their influence and their vision. Executive coaches are investing in their professional leadership development. We hear repeatedly how valuable it has been to receive this kind of opportunity, and we're witnessing firsthand how these women leaders are paying it forward, developing others, and catalyzing institutional change. Now, imagine a world where CEO sponsorship is constantly met with women's leadership at all levels in an organization, and they are co-creating solutions, co-creating the definition of success and the measures for accountability. We need more spaces where diverse stakeholders come together. Heads of state talk to each other and they talk to governments. NGOs talk to each other. Frontline workers talk to communities. We're all developing separate solutions in silos, and we're not hearing from each other or from those whom we wish to design these solutions for. It's ironic how we keep taking top-down, outside-in approaches to creating equity. If we want buildings to be accessible, we need to put persons with disability in charge. If we want community health workers to feel safe and valued, we need to let them lead and design solutions for their environment. If we want to create an enabling environment for women, we need to put women in charge. And for those of us who have privilege and power, we need to sit back, listen, learn, reflect, create space, put our might and resources behind those whom we wish to elevate. Let them tell us about their definition of success and how to measure change. Let them tell us how they want to hold the system and even us accountable. We need to go beyond rescuing women and girls and start listening to them. And this is very important. We can't just stop at who leads. We need to think about how they lead. We need to reimagine leadership for a more equitable world. I don't know what this reimagination will turn out to be, but I know that it must be different from today's top-down, traditional, patriarchal styles. I also know about the power of listening, empathy, authenticity, collaboration, and inclusion. These are not just words that sound good. These are the leadership styles that deliver results. So, if there's one thing you take away from my talk today, please take away that we cannot assume that leadership exists. We must invest in it, and most importantly, we must invest in the leadership of those who are marginalized. This is not only about parity or representation. This is not only about role models, but also about recognizing and learning from the expertise, lived experience, and talent of people who don't look like us or sound like us. We need a diverse set of leaders reimagining new approaches, new solutions, new environments, and new methods for holding us all accountable. These solutions don't lie in any one person on this stage. They don't lie in me. I mean, I have ideas, but they don't lie in me. They lie in all of us. And if you believe what I just said, then please indulge me and stand up. We're going to say three things together. Please stand up. Okay, with a lot of conviction and belief, please say after me. I am a leader. Now look at the person next to you, left or right. And say with a hell of a lot of belief, you are a leader. And now, finally, together, we are leaders. Thank you. Thank you again for the time and space. Please have a seat. I have a rock star to introduce. Annika Jane is the head of advocacy for Amplify Girls, where she champions the uptake of girls' agency as a critical measure towards girls' success. And we're going to hear from her next. Thank you.
Hello, everyone.
The rock star is here. Thank you. As you heard, my name is Anika. And today, I want to talk about humanizing accountability for gender equality. Now, it is never a good thing to be the last, almost youngest speaker standing between you and the closing address and the next important meeting, but indulge me for 10 minutes. Bear with me as I take you through why we should not be having this conversation in the first place, right? So as heard from our eminent speakers, the time is now, and if not now, then right now. The call is for the how, the we must do. Today I want to talk about the who must do. I want to ask simple but hard and uncomfortable questions and wonder aloud, hopefully together, about how we on a daily basis push further and further away the dream of a working system towards gender equality. And today, I want to submit to you that the umbrella of accountability includes conversations, actions, and implementation around three major things. One, inclusive and intersectional resourcing. Two, agency. And three, personal leadership. We cannot talk about accountability without these things, right? And it is indeed a sad shame that we have to mainstream the conversation on accountability, because that means we have built a defective ecosystem around the implementation of gender equality. Now, how can we expect the world to achieve gender equality while our systems towards achieving it are highly siloed, highly exclusionary, and in some instances, very resistant towards change? We have many times called for decentralized resourcing, for localization. There have been quotas for gender spending. And now I want to call for affirmative action within affirmative action, because women, youth, and girls are not a homogeneous group. Do you know how much community organizations received in development funding last year, or even in COVID? The world spends almost $2 trillion, add some billions, in aid each year, but only 2% has gone to locally driven organizations. According to the Black Feminist Research, it says that less than 1% went to Black-owned women organizations. That means that we cannot even talk about young feminist organizations, right? There are hundreds and thousands of girls worldwide whose lives have been changed by organizations in their communities. These organizations are insightful, they are effective, and they are responsive. But they are also excluded, they are also unrecognized, and they are under-resourced. Lastly, they are highly disrespected. At Girls Deliver, Stacey Abrams said, "True investment is angelic. It should come even before the proof comes." When we sit in our offices and say to community organizations that we do not fund overheads, what exactly do we mean? I mean, and more importantly, are you saying that from a volunteering desk? I think we need to get more practical and honest about what accountability means. Because yesterday, Her Excellency Pumzile reminded us that privilege is not always obvious to those who have it. We have set systems of finance. Gender activists and founders have consistently asked that we lessen the paperwork. Yet we have consistently said, that's a finance issue, you know them. Finance, it's complicated. But what is finance? Are there no people in finance, right? When as a program person, you attend a training and you are mandated to use a system of finance that is stringent, that is exclusionary, and then you come and tell young people and women that nothing for us, without us, I mean, the finance system was created without you. I mean, come on, let's have a conversation here. When we talk about decolonization and localization, are our grantees in these rooms for these conversations? How will you hold yourself to account when you cannot commit to that which you cannot communicate internally, right? You cannot even sell it to in your own organizations. How will you do it outside? We talk about girls' agency at Amplify Girls. And at Girls Deliver, we talked about agency in all spaces. Now, have we provided a safe space for actionable and tangible change for local organizations to demand accountability? Is there agency? We all know that there isn't. We know the system is designed to totally exclude even the thought of agency from the conversation. Local actors do not have agency to demand for accountability, because if they do, if they are consistent in their call for change, you will absolutely deny them money. You will defund them. You know this, and you practice this. But we want to shout on this stage about flowery language on accountability. One of the, you know, big multinational companies said about his company that in the beginning stage, it's just you. You can quit at any time. Nobody's going to care. You set about doing simple things first. The most important thing is to focus obsessively on the customer. The context in this space is, who is our customer? Which brings me to personal leadership. It is our individual responsibilities as heads of organizations, states, and multilateral institutions to take initiative to change the culture in our respective institutions. A big conference like this can encourage us. It can give us allies, but it cannot do the work for us. Is the finance system too complicated? Change it, prioritize it, create a budget for it. Do you not approve overheads in your organization because you don't want your money wasted? Get out of the office. Go to the field. Spend time with the people implementing and see where the loopholes are. You don't fund unscalable projects? Sit with your team. Let's reimagine scale. Let's humanize the impact of the statements we make. These statements that create policies and systems that choke gender equality actors. Let us create quotas for girls funding and community organizations, because when you do, you will not have to come back and tell us that you did. Your work and your grantees will tell us. And I want to submit to you all that it is possible. From Natalia Kanyem yesterday, we learned that 40% of UNFPA funding goes towards local actor. That quota, that leadership comes from the top. From the Generation Equality Youth Task Force and the UN Women National Gender Youth Activists, we experienced unprecedented youth access in multilateral spaces as never experienced before, towards the launch of the Generation Equality Forum under the leadership of Mama Pumzilem Lambo Nguka. From the Bill and Melinda Gates, we saw deliberate efforts to fund the Youth Task Force. Against all odds and segmented protocol, they funded the idea. Now, this is not to say that these examples of organizations have no sin. No, they're just snippets of possibilities. Realities are lived by many feminist organizations, the Frida Fund, the Black Feminist Fund, Amplify Girls, and many other feminist organizations who are changing the way we fund young feminists. Today, I put the leadership to this room to task. Usually, President Adesina, who was supposed to be here, says, Africa needs to make deals, deals, and more deals. So today, I say that we need action, implementation, and honest change. And so I say to any leader of an NGO, multilateral organization, and philanthropies, I say to you today that your time, your personal time for change has come. And it is not business, it is personal. To all fellow gender equality activists and young women, do not tire. Because a day will come when we will not have to have this conversation, this call for accountability, and that day will draw us all closer to achieving gender equality. Thank you.
Wow, she really is a rock star, isn't she? Annika Jane. And before that, Shireen and Wangeshi. So three rock stars. The lightning talks have inspired us to be feminists, if you weren't already a feminist. So just before we wrap up, we have a very important announcement on FGM from the Africa Network to end FGMC and the 2023 Kigali Declaration closing the funding gap. Asinat Mwitiga is CEO of Orchid Project Youth and FGM Network Kenya. And Nabila Iqbal is from the Asia Network to end FGM. She's based in Sri Lanka, so they will both give us the announcement. Here they come. Hello, ladies. Wonderful to see you. Hello.
Esteemed delegates, good afternoon. My name is Asinat Mwitiga, the CEO of Orchid Project. It is indeed an honor to stand before you this afternoon and share this platform alongside powerful gender advocates from across the globe. Women Deliver presents an incredible space for us all to reflect on our journey towards gender equality, highlight progress made, acknowledge the lessons we have learned, and engage in fostering solidarity for sustainable solutions on gender equality. While FGMC is a global issue, the African continent has the highest prevalence of FGMC than any other continent. It is often the voices of the African grassroots organizations and activists missing out in the global spaces of power and influence. While the campaigns against FGMC in Africa spans over four decades, it is astonishing that the continent has not established a regional network. It is with this background in mind that the Orchid Project and the Africa Women's Rights Advocates, alongside with our grassroots organizations in Africa, are excited to announce the Africa Network to End FGMC! Yay! This network, which will be led by the activists and survivors of FGMC and the gender-based violence, local activists, men and women alike, will act as a platform to unify strategic efforts and elevate African grassroots voices in all spaces of power and influence. The official launch of the established African Network to End FGMC will take place at the upcoming FGMC conference, set to be held in Tanzania in October of this year.
While the formal network is yet to take shape, it will represent a unified collective of organizations and individuals all united with a single mission of eliminating FGMC once and for all in all our African countries. In Africa, we say that it takes a village to raise and protect a child. The network, the first of its kind, Africa-led and based initiative, it envisages bringing together all actors in this space to facilitate learning and creation of critical synergies. We therefore appeal to all those who believe in collective power, just like ourselves, to join us in this exciting yet crucial journey to ensure that our girls and women are protected from this violation of their fundamental human right. We will only be free once we are all free. A stick in a bottle cannot be easily broken. Our collective resolve must be firm and unbroken until every woman and girl on the African continent is free from the threat of FGMC. Esteemed delegates, the African Network to End FGMC. Thank you.
Thank you.
So over 200 million girls and women alive today from 31 countries have experienced female genital mutilation or cutting, and over 4 million girls are at risk of undergoing FGMC annually. And this number is on the rise. However, even these alarming figures fail to represent the full picture, especially in the Middle East, Asia, even in my home country, Sri Lanka. Rapid population growth, insecurity, humanitarian crises threaten to roll back the progress we have made. The critical lack of funds to the FGM sector only makes this worse. The inclusion of FGMC in the SDGs was ambitious, but that rhetoric was simply not matched with financial commitments. According to the UNFPA, we need $2.4 billion to end FGMC in 31 priority countries by 2030. This does not even include the countries that FGMC is known to have taken place. But we only have $275 million in development assistance, leaving a funding gap of $2.1 billion. So how do we turn this rhetoric into reality and close this funding gap? So hundreds of activists, grassroots organizations, INGOs, academics gathered at the Women Deliver pre-conference on FGMC to launch the Kigali Declaration and call to close the funding gap. I want to read an excerpt of this Kigali Declaration to you. But are you ready to listen?
Yes!
Okay, good. Dear world leaders and donor community, first, we need you to act with extreme urgency and significantly increase funding towards FGMC. It's essential for investment to come from a variety of sources, multilateral donors, philanthropy, private sector, government. Every day we do not act, 11,000 girls are at risk of being cut, undermining their right to health, bodily integrity, freedom from violence, and also to enjoy their sexuality. Second, we are calling on donor communities to shift the funding to grassroots organizations. We know that one of the most effective ways to end FGMC is to engage the community at the grassroots, but yet that funding is patchy and it's unsustainable, and frontline women only get 2% of big donor funding. Finally, third, we are calling on key stakeholders to convene a global commitment summit. With less than 7 years until the 2030 deadline, action is needed to resource the end FGMC sector. And my fellow advocates and I, who gathered at the FGMC pre-conference, call for a global summit for increased financial commitments to achieve the elimination of FGMC. We are in a race against time. We do not have the luxury of time, and failure is just not an option anymore. Thank you.
Thank you, Asenat and Nabila. Thank you so much. I add my voice to theirs. End FGM now. More funding for FGM. And just to wrap up, a few highlights from our discussions today. We will tell leaders, world leaders, your time is up. It's time for gender equality now and end FGM now. To accelerate progress on gender equality, we need to ensure that accountability strategies are inclusive and that they prioritize the needs and priorities of women, girls, persons with disabilities, and vulnerable groups. We need data in the hands of feminists to inform their advocacy. Young women are ready to lead the change they want to see. And it's essential that we have a strong and persistent civil society that keeps an eye on government commitments. Finally, focused leadership matters. Many thanks to you for being with us today, and hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. I'll see you tomorrow morning at the session on climate justice. So see you then. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for being here.